Hello, everyone. How are you doing this day? It's a beautiful sunny day here in the Netherlands. Tell me in the chat where you're coming from. I'm happy to hear that. Thank you. Thank you for having you in this already 10th Power Webinar with General Pieter van Uhm. So please use the chat to tell me where you're from. Hi, Desiree. Hello, everybody from the Netherlands and from USA, Steve. Good morning, Steve, I guess. We are about to begin. We wait a few minutes until everybody has joined this webinar. Let me also know if it's your first webinar, your second. Today, this is our 10th Power Webinar, and we will keep on going. On Thursday, already our 11th Power Webinar. So how many times did you join our webinars? Let us know. Thank you, Koos, for having you for the first time. Hello, Theo from Beijing. Oh, many, many first at the fourth, fifth time, Monique. Thank you for being here again. Yeah, let's start. Let's start. I will do a little explanation because we have many people who are here in this webinar for the first time. The most important button in this webinar program is the button in top of your screen. When you suffer from internet connections, please use that button and it will reconnect you to this webinar room. On the other side, you are already using the chat function, and during the webinar, Pieter van Uhm is happy to answer all your questions. Let me invite Pieter van Uhm. Please join us. Hello, Pieter. let's try your. I don't think we hear you. Don't worry, you know what to do. Just log off and log on again, and the problem will be solved. So that was the briefing test before our webinar. It's with the digital things. It can happen, of course, no sound. I hope you hear me. Let me know, does everybody hear me? Only Pieter van Uhm. So we just wait for him. Okay, people hear me. It's just 1 minute. He will join us with a sound because we all like to hear. Yeah, thank you for sharing that everybody hears me. But most important is, of course, that Pieter van Uhm will have a sound because we all know him from different stages. So we wait a minute until he joins us. There he is. Yeah. Now it's working.
Can you hear me now?
For sure. I can hear you.
Okay, then. Well, good afternoon, or maybe good morning to everybody.
Good morning, maybe good night. Somebody woke up during the night. Thank you, Peter, for having you in this 10th Power webinar, of course. And of course, I know you very well for a long time, because you are one of the speakers of Assembly Speakers. But tell us this a little other thing that we share.
Yes, we have a small secret together. I'm an ambassador of the Dutch Foundation for Service or Assistant Dogs. And my wife and I, we get a puppy of 2 months old. And then we raise that puppy to a good, well-mannered and easygoing dog. And then he goes into the training to become a service dog. But unfortunately, some dogs don't get to the end of the program. And well, we had a blonde Labrador pup, Nolan, who got to the final stage and he went into the in the training. But unfortunately, during the training, he got a sickness on his right eye with a big chance to become blind on that eye. So he couldn't become a service dog. And so we were looking for a family who would take this dog as a family dog. And guess who now has Nolan in his family? That's you, Maurice.
That's our family, and especially also my wife, we always had a dog, and we were really looking forward to a new dog, but I was not in the situation of feeding a pup. And I think I asked you the question at the right time.
Absolutely.
How is Nolan doing? And you share that with me. I think his birthday is on the 14th of on the 14th of May. We got the dog, and we are very happy. And between you and me, he is really a blonde dog. a lot of times. So
yeah. Maurice. Not everybody of those who listen in know what a service dog is. So maybe I better explain what these dogs do. Because this foundation, they raise dogs for people who are in a wheelchair. And this dog helps them in their daily life. They get at least 75 tricks, so to say, to help them. Push the light button, get things out of the fridge, put your laundry into the washing machine and getting out again. And then besides these 75 tricks, they get the special tricks they have to learn for this client. This could be to roll them over if they are crippled, and roll them over in bed. So that's one direction where a dog can go. Then we have dogs who are dogs for people who have the epileptic disease, and they learn to feel how this client is. And for instance, our second dog, Sander, he warns his boss, Annette, she's a female, he warns her 1 hour in advance when an epileptic attack comes. And while when you're lying in a hospital with all these things on your head, they can only in advance tell you 60 seconds. And this dog is doing it 16 minutes. And this gives a huge improvement of her life and the quality of her life. Then we have dogs who help veterans or police officers or fire department people who have a post-traumatic stress disorder. And they help them to get through the daily stress, so to say. And they sometimes know their boss better than the boss knows himself, because they warn him and they build up stress so that they can get away out of this situation. And then we have therapy dogs, and these dogs, they help children who have behavioral problems together with our therapists to improve their life and their behavior. And when I started as an ambassador in this foundation, I once said that these dogs improve the quality of life of the clients. But more than one client said to me, no, Peter, you're wrong. The dog is not improving my quality of life. No, the dog is giving my life back to me. And that's how important these dogs are. But also, if then a dog can't become a service dog. It's great that people like you want to give a warm home to these dogs.
So to make it clear, it's not only for the soldiers who are coming back and need a help. It's also for children. You're telling. I make my connection now with one of my children who suffers from epileptic disease. Those dogs. For me, it's very important. What made you decide to become that great ambassador for that foundation?
Well, the reason why I did this was rather simple. I retired from the military, and I was figuring out what I should do. And then I got a call from the director of this foundation, and he asked me if I would be so kind to hand over the first PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, dog to a client. And I asked him, okay, let me think on that. And I didn't know anything about service dogs or PTSD dogs. So I just, on the internet, was looking, and I saw this was big in America, in the UK, in Canada. So I took up contact with this director again, and I asked him, okay, this seems great, but who's the client? And then he mentioned the name of this client, and I knew this sergeant major. He was present in the unit of my son. I knew him personally. So I immediately said, yes, I will do this, but I want to visit the foundation. And then I went with my wife to the foundation. And in the car, I said to her, be aware, they will ask us questions. They want us something to do for the foundation. And we already talked to the two of us, maybe we can be a guest family and raise some of these puppies. And so when we were chit-chatting over coffee, my wife and I said, now we have a question. How is this about these guest families that host a puppy? And the two directors looked at each other. One ran away, came straight back with a 2-month-old brown Labrador puppy, put it on the lap of my wife, said, so you want to be a guest home for our puppies? And well, if you have a Labrador puppy on your lap, you can only say yes.
I totally understand. This webinar is all going about the human aspect, but the connection with dogs, of course, we can learn as human beings, we can learn a lot from the human aspect. Last week, exactly 1 week ago, we had Lieutenant General Marty Greif and Unstoppable Tracy in our webinar. Marty Greif chose for being a chairman of the Invictus Games, a beautiful other foundation. Can I say foundation? It's like the Olympic Games for injured soldiers.
Absolutely.
It's a beautiful happening, and we should all more focus and engage with those kind of great events. Next year in May in The Hague, beautiful. And now from going to from the dogs to the human aspect, of course. Who is Peter van Uhm really? Who is your father? Who is your grandfather?
Well, I was born in a part of the city of Nijmegen at the east of the Netherlands, close to the German border. My parents had a bakery in a neighborhood where at those days already there was a mix of laborers, students, first immigrants who came to work in the Netherlands. So it was a mixed population in that neighborhood. And I have an older sister and a younger brother. And with this family, we had to work with everybody who was there to get the bakery running. And as young kids, we already learned from our parents a lot of important things. So we learned from them that you should have respect for the people outside of your family, and also for their goods, their materials. And they also teach us very young that, yes, you can have responsibility, but you have to live up to that. And my father told me that in a simple way. I was a young kid, primary school, And he took me to the bakery and he put me on a big lump of wood. And I looked over the working bench that he had. And he had all the tins, the baking tins he had there. And he showed me how he could grease with some stuff, a little oil, how he could grease all these bakery tins. A rather stupid, simple action. And he then let me do it. And he let me do all these tins with a brush. We didn't have machines in those days. And when he said, okay, that's the way you have to do it, he said, and as of now, this is your responsibility. So when I came from school, I had no excuse playing with my friends or doing homework for school. No, it was my responsibility to grease all these baking tins. And I knew that when I did a lousy job, my daddy would have a problem next day, because then the loaves wouldn't come out of these baking tins. And so in a simple way, our parents teach us, yes, you have a responsibility in life, and you have to live up to that. And my father told stories about the Second World War, and I thought it was very interesting, and I started reading on the Second World War. And so when on secondary school I had to decide what I wanted to do, I had learned that freedom, safety, peace, that's not for free. You have to do something for it. And so I decided I wanted to be a military officer, and I wanted to go to the Royal Military Academy. And that was great for me, because I could then have the best of both sides, because I was young and enthusiastic. I wanted to do a lot of adventurous things, but I also knew how important freedom was, and I wanted to do something like that. So this went together very well.
Yeah, and your grandfather, what did he do?
My grandfather, he was a farmer, but he also had the local, what we call pub in this language, in his village. And at my father's home, they had what you see in the musical, the Sound of Music, a family with a lot of kids. So when my grandfather went there, and all the kids came behind him, and it was the grandfather of my father's side. But the grandfather from my mother's side, he was a baker too.
Yeah, beautiful. And your father wasn't disappointed that you not became a baker?
Oh, my father was rather conventional in his thoughts. So the eldest was a daughter, so she could go to the university, no problem. But he had his hope on his two sons that they would take over the bakery. And to be very honest, my younger brother was a better baker than I. When we were working together making cookies, his cookies were always better than mine. So, and my father saw that too. So he hoped that, at least the younger son would be a baker. But unfortunately, my younger brother believed all my stories on the military academy. And when he had to decide, he told my parents, by the way, I'm going to do the same thing that as Peter has done. I want to go to the military academy.
Yeah,
thanks. So yes, a little bit disappointed he was.
Yeah, for sure.
But later on, he was very proud on all three of his kids.
That's beautiful to hear. Of course, a lot of people have seen your TED Talk. Millions of people at the moment. People, if you haven't seen it, please watch it maybe again and another time. Of course, the title of that TED Talk was Why I Chose the Gun. And you shared already a little bit what freedom means for you.
Yeah.
And maybe that's the connection, of course. I think there's also the connection between you and me. We met each other at a restaurant close to where I live.
Yeah, that's right.
My first meeting with you, and you stood up and walked to me and greeted me, and you are so proud that so many people watched your
absolutely test. That was unbelievable.
Yeah, but yeah. I think there was at that moment 50,000, around 50,000. But when you watch it now, when you see the views now, it's 3-4 million, maybe more, of course, because
yeah. And then you see how important social media are, because my TED talk was seen all over the world, and it's still used at military education centers and training centers. And just a nice story, I was at a NATO summit in Washington, walking with our prime minister, our minister of defense, our minister of foreign affairs, and a American captain comes rushing in his ceremonial outfit, and he said, "You, sir, I've seen your TEDx talk." Now, an American captain, he really doesn't know who the prime minister of the Netherlands is, so he hadn't a clue who the group was with whom I was standing. So he jumped in and he said, "I've seen your TEDx talk. I had my whole company in the cinema. They all had to watch." And then I said, "Well, thank you very much. That's that's an honor for me too. And by the way, this is the prime minister of the Netherlands." He was fully puzzled.
Yeah. And of course, it's the time, of course, with TED Talk, only 18 minutes. So you must do it, you must show it. And yeah, at the moment, there are so many TED Talks.
It was especially important that because I try to tell people how important freedom is, that you have to do something for it, and that a democratically controlled armed force is a force for good. And of course, it was peculiar because I think I was one of the first, or maybe the first soldier in uniform doing a TED Talk. So it flew over the world in no time.
And that gun, of course, on stage. And that gun, of course, okay. That.
Yeah, of course. That was a little bit of a gamble, because the Dutch audience is not used to having a gun close to them. Mm-hmm. But if you look at the link and at the film, then you will see that when I turn with the gun to the audience, then you see me a little smile on my face, because I see the whole audience in the room, they all do this. Oh, that's the moment that I know this is going to work.
Yeah, it's impressive. There was another speech that was impressive, especially when I think you made the whole Dutch population silent at the time. And it was at Memorial Day. Speech at the Dam in Amsterdam. When I'm talking about it, I'm still getting emotional because, yeah.
I think that the people who are from abroad, they don't know this speech. I think that the mass of the Dutch people have seen this. It was on the 4th of May of 2013. It was the first time that our king was present as a king at our National Memorial Day. And when they asked me to do this talk, well, you have the saying from put a patient at rest. They said to me, "Well, you can calm down. There are only 25,000 people standing on this dam square. And because the king is for the first time, probably about 8 million will be on the telly. Just do your thing." So I was a little bit nervous, and the message I sent, because for those people who don't know, you only officially have 3 to 4 minutes for your presentation, so you have to be very concise. And what I brought to the audience, to the people, is that it's not about me. It's not about I, it's about we, it's about us, and that that you have to serve others, and then we will solve all the problems. But the most difficult sentence in my speech was when I referred to my son, and when I had to say that I was proud of my son, because there was so much emotion in that sentence, and it was the first time I openly addressed and talked about my son, so that was hard. That was difficult.
I can imagine. And yeah, there's one thing, of course, what never had happened during Memorial Day, during a speech of Memorial Day. People were applauding for you, for your speech.
Yeah, yeah, that was quite unusual because you just had the 2 minutes of silence. And so everybody is in this atmosphere, these 2 minutes of silence, and normally it stays quiet, whoever held a speech there. And this was, well, yeah, very emotional. I didn't hear the applause because I knew you are standing on a small stage and you have a rather, well, awkward stairs, 3 or 4 steps downwards. And I knew your speech can be as good as can be, but if you fall from these stairs, then nobody will remember your speech. So I was so focused on getting from the stairs, getting back to my place, and there somebody said to me, Peter, don't you hear? There is applause. And then I heard that people were applauding.
Mm-hmm. You already mentioned about your son, of course. I don't want to go deep in that, but fathers, mothers, I'm a father. Yeah, people can imagine. Was the day after you were appointed as the chief of defense? There was a special moment as well. So,
I always said that if a scenario writer wrote this scenario, people would laugh. They just laugh him away. On one day, the festivity of me taking over the job of chief of defense from Dick Balang, and the next morning your son is killed in the mission in Afghanistan. And of course there were people who said that they specifically aimed at my son, but this was bullshit. Nobody outside of his unit knew that he was there. He didn't have his name tag, only his first name. But the media didn't know, so he was just on the wrong place on the wrong time. He had bad luck together with his driver and the 2 soldiers who were severely injured sitting in the back of his car.
And connecting now with what's happening today, we all are in the same problem, in the same lockdown, of course. That was a moment, of course, of making a decision. Keep on going, or just choose the other way. How did you get that moment?
For a moment, I couldn't hear you, but I'll pick it up, Maurice.
So to make the decision, go further.
Yeah, or take of course. Yeah. Well, for me, for my family, this was the worst thing that can happen. We were, if you may say so, in a crisis, and I said all the wrong things, be honest on that, but in the end we came back to our sense, and my wife and I, we looked at each other and we said, well, if I now quit as chief of defense or as a soldier, then we will not only lose our son, but we will lose everything that he believed in and that we believe in. So, of course, at that moment, everything that I had in my backpack full of experience was needed. But in the end, we as a family, it was not only me, we as a family, we decided to take on our life and go on so that our son could be proud on us. So we tried, it wasn't easy, but with the 4 of us, we tried to pick up life again and to go on serving our society. And looking at the crisis where our society is, well, the whole world is in now, we all have choices and we all have our responsibilities, but you have to stick to your moral compass. You have to stick to the values and ethics that makes it so that you still can look in the mirror and be happy with yourself, and that you can say, yes, this is why what I want to be, this is what I want to do, and this is what I want to contribute, this is the way I want to serve. And after my speech at the Memorial Day, a lot of people came to me and they said, yes, we understand. Where in the military service, you can serve. Well, they didn't listen good enough. because everybody can serve. And in the COVID crisis, we know, yes, in healthcare, these people serve. They are our heroes nowadays. But you can, in the educational system, you can serve. As an entrepreneur, you can serve. But you have to do it always with a right moral compass. And as an entrepreneur, you have to do it with a good corporate social responsibility. And then you can contribute to society.
Yeah, nice. There's now a moment, of course. Of course, I understand that people have questions. So please join us with questions. One question is Joep van Deursen. Has training service dogs also helped you cope with this massive personal loss?
I'm not sure. I'm not my own psychiatrist also, but dogs do understand when you are sad. Dogs do understand when you have emotions. And it helps if you can pet a dog. And if a dog comes, just sit next to you show you, let's be calm, I understand you, and we are here together. So and I think in that respect, yes, it has helped not only me, but my wife too, that we worked with these dogs. And our first dog became a PTSD dog. So he understands people. He feels how people feel. Our second dog became a dog for somebody with an epileptic disease. So he understands people. So yes, these dogs must have helped us.
Yeah. Thank you. And is of course, we can learn a lot from these dogs. Maybe my question to you is, should we all human beings not more being a dog, like how a dog is giving us a lot?
Oh, yes. I think that dogs without self-interest give a lot to people. Although if you look at Labradors, they like to work for their food. So there is a little bit of self-interest, but still, yes, dogs like to help, to serve their boss, the client, so we can learn from them, absolutely. But now, even in this crisis, at least the dogs stay calm.
I think in one of my earlier webinars, I mentioned it before about the school system of. And of course, we as parents learn now even more about our own children. Would it but not be a great idea to teach our children how to use our intuition, how to trust our feeling?
Yeah, but that goes for everybody. And that's also with leadership. Leadership starts with yourself. You have to know yourself. You have to know your emotions, your instincts, your values. Absolutely. Yep. And especially in times of crisis, when we talk about leadership, then leaders have to step up. Mm-hmm. And what I see now when I work with, after my retirement, with companies and foundations and all aspects of our society, in a crisis, I see leaders who want to solve the problems of today. And they forget to think about tomorrow. And so they have a big chance that they are solving the problems of today while creating the bigger problems for tomorrow. And I always urge these people, when they take decisions, and you have to be decisive as a leader, even in crisis, especially in crisis, then think also about the longer term effects, but also the broader effects of your decisions and your actions. And you know that you don't have all the information that you want. Well, we as soldiers say, if you wait that you have all the information that you need, you will always be late. And that's especially in a crisis. Yeah. And so I want to, well, live my life in that way. And I want to look at the longer term. And just to give an example, before Easter, together with a few people from non-governmental organizations, people from industry, we wrote a pamphlet and we signed it, and we gave it to the leaders in parliament, and we asked there to give 1% of the Dutch COVID crisis budget. So what we suggested was take 900 million euros and spend them in failing countries and countries who don't have such a good, robust healthcare system as we have. Because we think you have to think on the longer term, but it's also a moral obligation to help others. And this goes hand in hand with our own interest. Because if we help these people, then we don't inflict our own health system. We don't inflict our security. We don't inflict our economy. So we help ourselves too, and this goes hand in hand. So we did that to think on the longer term. We tried to force our politicians to think on the long term. And the government decided that they would ask an advice from the Advisory Board on International Affairs. And they gave the advice now to the government not to spend 900 million euros, but a billion euros on this. And we should also, what we asked, take other countries with us, take the lead, because we can't solve this on our own. And I think this is just an example on how you have to deal with the crisis as a leader and as a human person.
Beautiful. And are we now only focusing on the European countries or also on Africa what's happening in Africa at the moment?
No, Maurice, we are really aiming at African and Asian countries who don't have such a robust healthcare system as we have. And we have to work together in the international community to help these countries and those populations. It's now up to the government to decide.
Beautiful. There are a lot of questions. Of course, if we cannot answer all the questions, Pieter van Uhm is happy to answer the questions that are not being answered in this webinar after the webinar, but we try to do as much as we can. Let me see.
I see a nice question from Hans van Lamoen.
Yeah. Would it be possible to teach society how to become more morally correct in its behavior?
Well, I hope that we can teach that. And just looking from the military, the recruits that come in, they don't have all the right moral compass. They don't understand all the values and ethics that you need as a soldier. And we as the military, we also set an example for society. So our young instructors, they teach the recruits what our standards are. And that's doable. We get military, we get every year a few thousand recruits, and we train them not only for their professional skills, but also for their moral compass, that it would be right. And so we should do that in society. And then, unfortunately, I see that often people refer to the schools. Well, sorry, but it starts in the family with the parents. Just like my parents taught me how to take up responsibility, kids should learn it at home. And of course, schools also have responsibility there. And I often get the question, why shouldn't we have a conscription anymore? Dienstplicht in Nederlands, in Dutch. And I'm a firm advertiser of a new conscription in the Dutch society. And I often ask people, can you agree with me that we should show our youngsters that society is not only there for them, but that they are also there for society, that they can contribute and they should contribute? And everybody says yes. So at the moment, our Deputy Minister Paul Blokhuizen, he is working on a voluntary conscription where youngsters can contribute to our society. And I hope that we come to the situation like, it's a little bit similar, not quite similar, but like in France, where they have this already, they call it the service social. And if you solicit at a governmental position, or you solicit at a big company, and you have contributed with a few months or a year service social, then you have a plus, a bonus to all the other competitors. And that's maybe the way to go.
Thank you. Mariel, I met her in Los Angeles, and you know her also very well, Peter. Her question is, with your military background and raising the service dogs and retaining your moral compass, we now live in Corona crisis. How do you cope? What do you expect the society to react in short and longer term?
Well, first of all, everybody should stick to the safety rules and regulations that were made. And I really hope that those who have to make this difficult call, so our governments, will do what is needed for society and not what society wants. We have to be firm here, and they have to be brave to take these difficult decisions. And I hope that they are now statesmen and not politicians. So then we have to do it all together in the society. And everybody has to stick to the regulations. I see in the Netherlands that a lot of people now are fed up with the regulations and they want more freedom. But yes, your freedom can see to it that other people get sick, maybe you too, but others too. And you have a bigger responsibility than your own life. So yes, it needs endurance from all of us, but I hope that we do the right things together.
Do you think that, why is it happening that we are more human, of course, getting more human because of all this, and that we are more thinking of collaborating with one another? It's connected with how soldiers live. Maybe we can connect those two stories.
Well, how soldiers live, camaraderie is something from the military. And I always say that that is the quadruple of friendship. In the end, some people will step in front of their colleague when there is fire at, because he will do that for me too. But if I look at our society now, and I see it in a lot of countries, I see that, yes, people are rethinking how important things in life are. Is the second car important, or your house important, or maybe it's health and freedom is more important than all the material things. So we are rethinking what is important, not only for our own life, but also for society. If you see that the role and responsibility of the government gets a whole new, is a whole new phenomenon at the moment. And I hope that we all see that what we did the past weeks, the past months together to cope with this crisis, that we keep on and cling on to this societal cohesiveness, and that we don't lose that when the crisis, once it is over. And I hope that we learn from that, that in the end, when you help others, you help yourself too.
But how do soldiers then feel? Is there one mission, one focus, what gives them more energy to reach that goal? Because I see in the past we are more looking to ourselves, more individual, and what we see now in the lockdown, that so many human initiatives, not only in our country, Holland, we see that in Belgium, we see that all over the world, that people are more willing to give.
For soldiers, that's normal. It's all about the team, all about the objectives of the team. And that goes first. And you take care of your colleagues, and they will take care for you. We teach them that. If they don't know it, we will teach them that. Our young instructors, I can't get it out of my system after 40 years in the military. But so.
What's the reason why we human beings lose that at a certain time? Why don't we keep those human values to give and to take care of one another. Because yeah, we see the elderly people, of course, they are very lonesome, and now we see that. We are not blind for that anymore.
Well, then we have to go back a few decades. when my parents started their life, as their working life, it was the time after the Second World War. We all had to contribute. We had to rebuild the country. And then prosperity went better and better. This was okay. But a lot of people also thought that all these material things are very important. We forgot how important it is to do things together, to be there for another, how important your safety and your freedom is. And so all kinds of material things, and it's all about me, became a bit of the focus. If you look at the industry, it became all, the only thing that was important were the shareholders. Hey, where were the stakeholders? So I hope, I really hope that this COVID crisis learns us again that there are other things that are...
That's also one of the reasons why we organize these power webinars, to show the world. That's why we do it in English, to show the world that we not live in one country, that we are all equal, that we are all human beings, and that we should take care for one another. And that we now see the biggest problems are the hunger problem. The biggest problems is climate, of course. And we cannot solve these kind of problems from one country. So we must all get together and focus in solving that to create that better place for not only us, but for the next generation, children and grandchildren, of course.
Yes, but Maurice, but that then you touch on what's really the problem, because we are talking about the international community who have together have to help the poorer countries or the states that are going to fail. And unfortunately, if we look at history, you see that we only step in when things went really wrong, when the misery is there, when a lot of personal loss is there. Being the international community first needs all this misery before they can step up and find themselves, find cohesion, and then they come. But then a lot of the misery already is done. And we should be more proactive.
That's again very human, to just only start when the problem already is visible. And then we once again connect with our dogs who have that intuition and feel the problem already coming.
Yeah, but we have a Dutch saying, which I will translate literally: it's better to prevent than to cure. And we should keep that in our mind. Because otherwise we will still see a lot of misery. But unfortunately, I sometimes have to say that man learns from history, but mankind learns rather poorly. And we always make the same mistakes.
But nobody will forget, even our children, this year. And what we in China see, maybe in next virus, but we are not talking about it. Lisbeth has another question. What was triggered by the corporate behavior? How will we deal with this when we slow? Do you see the question? How we will deal with this when we slowly come back from this lockdown? It connects with exactly what I'm talking about. Okay, the lockdown is over. Are we not afraid that people do the same thing again before the lockdown?
Well, as I just said, we learn rather poorly from history. I hope that we learn from this crisis. And that's a responsibility of everybody, but especially from the leaders. So, and I'm not talking only about governments, no. I talk about leaders of schools, leaders of companies, leaders of sports unions. We all have to learn from this crisis how important some things are, and that we should keep them in our mind and act on that. If we don't do that, then we will fall back in the same thing like a year ago.
I understand. What I am seeing, I'm connected with the whole speaking and event industry. Next Thursday, there will be a Dutch happening where we all collaborate with the whole event industry. It's beautiful to see. So we do it together on a voluntary basis. Connecting, of course, with the world, connecting with the next world, what is going to be, and we don't know. There is another question from Saskia. What is the role of female peacekeepers in the United Nations operations?
Well, I think that's very important. And to be very honest, when the military go in the missions, there are tasks that men just can't fulfill. In the countries where we work, people are very proud, although they have nothing. But they are proud on the few things that they have. And when we go to the males in the villages, then they are proud people. They say, no, we have no problems. But talk to the mothers in the villages, and you will hear what the problems are. But you can't, in a lot of countries, you just can't with male soldiers go to the females. You need female soldiers to contact them and to get acquainted with their, to hear what the real problems are. Just imagine that male soldiers would have to search a female that's wearing a burqa. You will have a row. So the females, we need them for specific tasks, but besides that, put a few females in a military unit and you will see that the atmosphere in the unit will change for the better. So the females are very important. I saw a question whether ethics should be embedded into our education system. thank you, Monique Joosten, for that question, because I think that's very important. Yes, absolutely. All our, and when we talk about education, it's the parents, but also all the teachers at schools, the professors on the universities, they all have to set the example, and they all have to speak up when things go wrong, and they have to set the standard on ethics. So implicitly, it should be there. But explicitly, you should talk on this with youngsters, because then you educate them. Tell stories. That's the best weapon you have on ethics, storytelling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, of course, that's most important. We are connected through stories. The human beings is connected through stories. And pass it over to the next generation. Coming back to leadership, of course. What I experienced, what I wanted to say earlier, what I see that, in fact, everybody is a leader. Every human being is a leader. And sometimes, also connected with what we are talking about now, with stories. It's not only telling the story, I think, always on you must be the story. Do you find your story for your life? How do you see that?
Well, basically, I'm a simple man. What you see is what you get. Everybody heard about my son, but still, I feel very lucky. The things I have done in my life, I was able to do. I did crazy stuff. I was one of the people who worked on a robbery of more than 10 banks at the same time, although it was in Bosnia and Herzegovina. But who can say that he's a certified bank robber and get away with that? So I did crazy, crazy things. Give your experience to the new generation. Tell them what they can learn. So that you contribute to a better world, and you will. Everybody will be challenged on his objectives, his moral compass, and that are moments that you have to rethink what you did and find the right way and so that you at least in the evening you look in the mirror and can say, I did the right things, I took the right decisions.
What? What you have a daughter, Peter? What's the most beautiful thing for story that you tell her, that you give her?
Oh, I told her a lot of stories. And the partner of my son, she's a daughter to us. So we lost our son, but we got a second daughter, a bonus daughter, so to say. I told so many stories to them. So I won't pick one of them, but just a story about values and ethics, who you can be challenged, how you can be challenged. Just a story. In Afghanistan, I gave a unit a very difficult task. They had to capture a Taliban leader. And this guy is secured and safeguarded by a lot of people. And they succeeded. When I went to Afghanistan, I visited this unit too. And I asked them how this mission went. And then while talking with them, one of the soldiers, he was a sniper, he said to me, why am I making all these actions, taking the risks to get this guy and capture him? Just let me and my mate lie there for a day with our sniper rifle and I'll get him. That's much easier, no much risks. Then you are challenged by your soldier on the ethics of you, the values of your organization. And I talked with them and I said, well, when you do that, you look through your opticals and you see the face of this man. Do you think that this face will ever get away out of your mind? No, it will always be there. And if you know that you pulled the trigger while there were still other options, you will not be a happy guy. That is not what we do. We don't do the same things and the things in the manner that our opponents are doing the Taliban. And then at the end, I told to this group that I hope that they will be a grandfather or a grandmother in future. And when one of their grandchildren is sitting on their lap and asking them, hey, grandfather, grandmother, what did you do for my future? Then I hope you can be proud on your answer. And if you would have pulled the trigger while there were still other options, you're not proud on yourself.
It's beautiful. Are there any other questions for Peter van Uhm? Because we have a couple of minutes. Maybe we can already start to give them some takeaways. What can people do now for your thinking to start creating the future for themselves, of course, and for other people?
Well, I see one. It's not a question, much more a statement from Hans van Balamoen. Let's root for statesmen and the silent, sensible majority. Yes, don't forget that there are countries where people walk for hours, stand in a line for hours, just to fulfill their commitment, to take their right to vote. And we, the majority of the country, we decide in which direction our country goes. And we decide who are the politicians that we put in the position to become a statesman or a stateswoman. It's all of us. We decide. Mm-hmm. We have that responsibility.
Mm. Yeah. Other takeaways, Peter?
Well, if I'm for a conclusion, if we have some takeaways, then first I would say, serve your society, serve your family, serve your company, and then they will see what you do for them. And if you help others, you help yourself too. When you are in misery, just look at others and you see that some are even worse than you. Help them and you will get out of your misery. Mm-hmm. And then it's not about you or me, it's about us. And when we are looking at the crisis, I would say, take decisions. With your moral compass in your hand, take the decisions. Be brave, take action. And I always said it's easier afterwards to explain why you took an action and on for what reason than that you have to explain that you didn't do anything. Hmm. And then if you do that, I think you can be happy with yourself.
Yeah, that one, of course, again, the circle is round of this webinar. It starts with the dog. It starts to trust your feeling, to trust your intuition, and make that first step first, because you never know what the second or third step will be.
Yeah, absolutely right. And so after this webinar, I go walk the dog.
You go walk the dog. Just one, because last week you had two.
Yes, at the moment we have only one. Sometimes we have two, and in specific moments we even have three.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you for having you in this webinar. It was a very special webinar because we know each other for quite a few years now. We end this webinar, of course. If you still have questions for General Peter van Uhm, please feel free to send them by email. We copy the chat log. When we miss one or two questions, I think Peter van Uhm is happy to answer them in an email. So, thank you again. Next Thursday, what is called Heaven's Day, maybe Hemelvaart in Dutch. I'm not sure the English word, but it's a special free day for a lot of people. But still, we are organizing a webinar at 10 o'clock Central European time, and we go to the past, we stay in the present, and we go to the future with the world's wisdom coach Vikas Malkani, based in Singapore, and the well-known futurist of the Netherlands, Ajit Bakas. We are talking about, is it all karma or universal wisdom? So a little bit spiritual, but why is it this all happening? And what can we all do about it? I hope to see you on Thursday. And next week, it will be focused on stories, finding your story, finding your purpose. Also on Tuesday, but then 10 o'clock Central European time, and a special event on the Thursday. Peter van Uhm, thank you again. And we will meet each other very soon. First, walk the
Surely. And thanks for all the people joining us. And Maurice, thank you for the opportunity.
Yes. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for having you as well in this webinar. And hope to see you back again in our next webinars. Bye-bye.
Bye.